Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of High Energy Girl. Today I am super excited to have Randy from Radiant Health Saunas on the show. I have been studying and researching saunas for a long time. They have so many health benefits. My favorite one is there was a 20-year Finnish sauna or a Finnish study, and they looked at, I think it was 200 men over 20 years, and determined that regular sauna use, like I think it was four times a week, decreases all-cause mortality by over 40%. Isn't that crazy? I mean, like, what else on the planet can actually make that claim? So I have been wanting a sauna for quite some time. I've been doing a lot of research. My friend, who is a bigger research nerd than I am, introduced me to Randy from Radiant Health Saunas, and he has so graciously provided us a discount for any of the listeners to High Energy Girl. If you just give him a call, head on over to his website, radianthealthsaunas.com, where he has all these like questions and different ways for you to evaluate the saunas that you're looking for. And he will actually take really good care of you. So if you just mention High Energy Girl, he will also give you a wonderful discount. So Randy found saunas accidentally because he was an adrenaline junkie, a firefighter, you know, very active outside. And he came down with fibromyalgia. And you know what? I'm not going to ruin his thunder. I'm going to let him tell you his story. So let's go and say hello to Randy.
You strive to keep your family healthy, bosses and employees happy, and the home life smooth. But now it's time to focus on you. This is High Energy Girl, a fun show focused on helping you get healthier and feel amazing. It's time to ditch the excuses and start living your best life. Here's your guide to help you increase your energy and empower your life. Health coach and personal trainer, Tracy Gluheit.
Give a woman a fish, feed her for a day. Teach a woman to fish, feed her for a lifetime. Teach a woman to teach a woman to fish, end world hunger. Have you ever wanted to help people improve their health journey? Have you thought about coaching people with a keto lifestyle? Would you like to become an integrative health coach? Well, the Institute for Integrative Nutrition, or IIN as we call it, is the largest nutrition school in the country. And in 2011, I graduated from their program and became a health coach. It was completely awesome. We learned over 100 different dietary theories and talk about craziness and confusion. My wish for you is that we can lock arms and create a tribe of health coaches all around the country, all around the world to spread the keto message. If this resonates with you and you would like to look into this option deeper, please go to my blog at highenergygirl.com and click on the link to the right of the homepage. Here you can grab the curriculum guide and see if it inspires you. Since I care so much about my listeners, I negotiated the very best tuition rate for you at IIN. Either you can contact them directly and give them my name, or I will introduce you to a counselor so you can decide if this is a good fit for you and your career goals. Let me know how I can support you in this coaching career opportunity. And don't forget to join our Facebook group, High Energy Girls. That way we can be in contact and chat every day. Hey, Randy, thanks so much for coming on the show today.
Oh, hi. Thanks, Tracy. Thanks for inviting me.
I'm super excited to have you here, partly because I want to learn more about the topic of saunas, and the others is because I know the health benefits and the healing, and I really, as a healer, want to help people. So I think you have a lot to share. So how about telling us a little bit about yourself?
Okay, sure. To be honest with you, I never thought I would be, you know, have a sauna company, but sometimes things evolve a certain way. I was a bit of an adrenaline junkie. I was on the mountain rescue team and the Whistler Ski Patrol and whitewater kayaker, and I was also a firefighter, so pretty active. And then I started, you know, had muscle skeletal pain, and they said I had fibromyalgia, or that label. And I'll be honest with you, I was pretty mainstream, pretty naive. And so I kind of went through the mainstream treatment, and I was just getting worse and worse. I reached a point where I had difficulty walking, couldn't hold on to a telephone, you know, so it was not that great. And
how old were you at that time?
I was 35.
That's very young.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's kind of, and it's one of those things where I didn't do a lot of woe is me, because I've seen people in a lot worse states dealing with different things. I was just more, okay, what do I have to do to get better? Now, what was helpful in my case, not good for the other fellow, but there's another fellow on my four-man crew about 8 months later came down with the same symptoms. I go, wait a minute, you got two healthy guys and either of us can work. So I had an adipose tissue sample sent to a lab in the U.S. It's called AcuChem Labs, and it turned out it was very high in a chlorinated pesticide used in treating wood products. And in our ignorance, late 80s, early 90s, we went to a roofing tar fire and didn't always have our breathing apparatus on. We had limited number of bottles and yada yada, and so that was probably where I was exposed. And so it got me onto a whole new journey as far as learning about detoxification, and that's how I got introduced to infrared saunas. And I always thought I was the exception. I happen to have this label of fibromyalgia, but I had a toxin problem. And to be fair, I lost my train of thought there. I didn't just do the sauna to get better. I changed my diet. I worked on my stage four sleep. I did a bunch of things, but the sauna was the most effective in lowering my toxic load, reducing my pain level. So I got very passionate about it, but I thought it was the exception. And then in 1996, I went to my first functional medicine conference in the States, and it was fascinating because there was people like Dr. Majid Ali, Leo Galland, Jeffrey Bland from Washington, just medical doctors who were kind of pushing the edge at that time. And it was fascinating. They said it really didn't matter what label they put on their patients, whether it was chronic fatigue or fibromyalgia, sometimes even MS and lupus, and you know, just different kind of, doesn't mean that everybody with MS or lupus has a toxin problem, but there's definitely some that do. So they used the analogy of a rain barrel. They said, here's the patient's toxic load. And over time, you know, the rain barrel, sometimes it's a final trigger that puts somebody over. It can be pesticide exposure, mercury from the mouth, or a car accident, or emotional trauma. And all of a sudden, it overflows the top of the rain barrel and puts pressure on the immune system, the thyroid, the digestive system. They said many of their patients have problem with or compromise with their phase 2 detox pathways. And so I realized it was kind of a big, you know, light bulb for me that, hey, I'm not the only one that would benefit from detoxification. A lot of us, our toxic load is too high. And so that's kind of, you know, I started to introduce the saunas to different clinics and different practitioners so that if someone couldn't afford to buy one, at least they could have a place to go to use it. So that's kind of the Coles Notes version of my journey of why I got into it.
Well, there's a lot to unpack there. So the first thing I want to talk about, because I really want to talk about the sauna thing, but the first thing that you mentioned that I'm not familiar with is, what is stage four sleep?
Well, a lot of people will call it the fibromyalgia label, and other people that have some chronic health problems have difficulty going into the stage four sleep, but it's where that you have the longer delta waves. I'll give you an example. There was Dr. Medalski in Toronto. He took some healthy university students. Nothing was wrong with them. Every time they went into the deep sleep, or we'll call it stage four sleep, he woke them up. And lo and behold, it only took about 10 days, and they had all the classic symptoms of fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. That's why it's so important to go into this, we'll call it this deep restorative sleep. I think we produce something like 80% of our growth hormones in our stage four sleep. That's why even a healthy person, if you're tossing and turning all night, you may almost wake up a little bit stiff and sore. So there's a few things you can do to help promote stage four sleep. A lot of them, it has to do with serotonin levels. So there's three natural serotonin precursors. I think there's SAMe, 5-HTP, and John's wort. And what may work for one person may not work for the other. You just have to be prepared if you have trouble with deep sleep. Some of the natural supplements, it's not like a medication that's you're going to get results overnight. So you have to be patient and maybe wait, you know, 10 days, you know, sometimes even 2 weeks before you really start to notice a difference. And so a lot of people with chronic pain issues or fibromyalgia or anything like that, it's very important to have that restorative sleep.
So what about GABA? Would that make that list or no?
GABA, to be fair, I don't know enough about GABA. I don't know if it's a serotonin precursor. I know it does help people with sleep, but to be fair, I've never really looked into GABA. I just looked at what I thought was the top three at the time.
Okay. Yeah, I've heard GABA is really good for calming. I sleep great. I take magnesium citrate before bed.
Yeah, that's very good too. And it's kind of, so, and that's a good point. Many of us are so low in magnesium. You know, it's even the average person, when people have chronic health problems, they're definitely low in magnesium. It's something to keep in mind with sauna use, as well as electrolytes. You definitely have to increase your magnesium levels. And if some people will say, well, I have trouble with magnesium, I just take any at all and I have loose stools. So how you could deal with that is you could take transdermal magnesium, which goes on as an oil or a cream, and it bypasses the gut. So that's something to keep in mind. Just do a little patch on your leg first, just to make sure you don't get a rash, because occasionally people do. But transdermal magnesium is a good way of taking in magnesium if you have trouble with the oral.
That's so funny that you mentioned that, because I, a long time ago, made this product. It was, I called it magnesium with 3 Z's instead of an S, and just sold it like at our little church, I don't know, like the little Christmas fair or whatever. And one of my good friends who's an international flight attendant, she just loves it because it helps her fall asleep quickly without like drowsiness. And so she's like, we've got to sell it. So she started making it. And I was trying to launch it on Black Friday, but like my shopping cart broke and I just failed. But she loves that stuff. And
yeah, no, it's definitely something. I think it's probably, they say the average person is low in magnesium. And it's something that I always think it's a mistake. You go to a typical health food store and they'll have a supplement that has two parts calcium and one part magnesium. And from the research that I've found and going to some of the functional medicine conferences, they said it should be just the opposite. It should be two parts magnesium and one part calcium, that your body needs that much magnesium for all kinds of, kind of enzyme functions and all kinds of things in your body.
Yeah. I always tell people to make sure they're getting their electrolytes, sodium, potassium, magnesium. And with the sauna, I'm sure that even helps. So I really want to talk about the sauna. So you said a lot in your intro statement. So kind of like backtrack and baby step it. So you started with changing your diet. How did you do that? What did you change your diet like?
I stayed away from excitotoxins and anything like aspartame, any of the something. I went organic. I didn't go vegetarian or vegan, but I definitely went organic and definitely went more alkaline. So I was a big one of taking your morning, take the urine sample, see the pH levels, just try to alkalize my body a little bit more. The diet was probably a big one. I really minimized or tried to totally avoid sugar. Those of us that have had some sort of intestinal dysbiosis, which is a polite way of saying you have imbalance of critters in your body, you try not to feed the fungi. And so I definitely went really very strict about my diet. Would never, no fast food, no junk food, just pretty healthy. And minimize my exposure to sugar.
Okay, yeah, that's good. So for the listeners that don't know, what are our excitotoxins?
Well, it'd be anything that's kind of added to the food. Sometimes it's a flavor enhancer. Sometimes it's, like I said, things like NutraSweet, aspartame, MSG, anything that might kind of trigger a reaction in your body. And so if you see a pack, it's always risky buying packaged foods unless you know the source. And so when you read the stuff, and there's a bunch of stuff in there, names or terms you don't know, then don't eat it. I'm not saying, we can't ever eat this stuff, but when you're dealing with a chronic health problem and you're doing everything you can to recover, don't underestimate the strength of a healthy diet.
Right, absolutely. Whole foods. That's what I advocate 99% of the time. So,
It doesn't mean I don't go over to a friend's place or go out for dinner and they may have added something I don't know. But when I was really sick, I was extremely strict, right?
Yeah, that's good. And it's funny, there's that documentary Food Matters that talks about aspartame and MSG, the two biggest toxins. And I think I would add trans fats too.
Yeah. No, good point. Yeah.
And high fructose corn syrup. I guess we can keep going. Okay. So
corn syrup is a lovely thing, isn't it?
Well, you know that, like, the city of New York City, okay, they banned, what was it, hydrogenated oils from any of the restaurants, and they said that it would save as many lives of people that are killed in traffic accidents.
Yeah, well, that's pretty cool that they came out and said that. It's probably true, right?
Yeah, I would believe it. So bad for you. Yeah. Okay, so then how, let's start with your sauna journey. So you start, you change your diet, you change your lifestyle, and your sleep. How did the sauna progression begin?
Well, the sauna, I started off, I didn't know about infrared saunas at the time, so I was using conventional saunas at a lower temperature and staying in there for a long time. There were some studies out there showing you could, with extended sauna use, you could lower your toxin load by about, you know, kind of 25 to 30%, and it was a protocol that I followed. And then I heard about infrared saunas, and it was way easier and better way to go. You could stay in there a shorter time period. If someone has never used an infrared sauna, you say, okay, the conventional temperature in a normal sauna would be 180 to probably 200 degrees Fahrenheit, maybe even occasionally 210, but in that range. Where a good infrared sauna, usually getting in around 115 Fahrenheit, maybe 120, and it's climbing up to, you know, maybe 150 at the most. So I might get in at 115 Fahrenheit, and I'm getting out at 145. But you sweat profusely. So the infrared is quite different. Far infrared, someone says, well, is this like a microwave? Is this like a radiation? You go, well, no. Far infrared is something that we're exposed to all the time. When you feel heat from someone else's body, that peaks about 9.4 microns. So you're actually feeling that heat, you're feeling far infrared. When you lay on the sand, in the summertime, you're feeling the warmth from the sand, that's far infrared, red or radiant heat. So it's something that we're exposed to a lot. So I was a biologist before I was a firefighter, had kind of a varied career. So I was a little bit, you know, I was worried myself as far as, okay, I really have to look into this infrared. And to be fair, most of the studies were on animals, some studies on people, but it showed, for instance, rabbits and mice, this is 24 hours a day being in a far infrared under the heaters, and it showed increased longevity and increased mobility. The only thing that I could find or advise, if someone is pregnant, I wouldn't use the sauna, because the infrared sauna, because it raises the core temperature. There's not any studies about infrared saunas in pregnancy, but there is, I think, even hot tub use, a woman should avoid doing that if she's pregnant. And also breastfeeding. I was getting some feedback that some of the kids were colicky, and a woman phoned me probably about 10 years ago or 12 years ago and said, is there any chance that has something to do with the sauna? And all of a sudden it hit me, and I thought, wow. And I phoned a toxicologist at the university here, and I asked her, is there a chance of immobilizing toxins in the breast milk? And she said, oh, definitely. So even though many women that are breastfeeding like it because it helps promote milk flow, I would strongly advise against it. You know, and some have continued, and the kids haven't had any problem, but it just makes sense to me not to do that when you're either pregnant or breastfeeding.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense too. Because then, and then, so how did you end up forming a sauna company? So you started out using a sauna, right?
Yeah. And then I started initially selling a product, and then there was a bunch of things that I didn't like about the product, and so then I thought, okay, what can I do? And I was selling to a lot of practitioners. By now I've sold to over 1,000, which is good because you're always getting feedback, and some of them are just as fussy as I am, which is great. And so I thought, okay, what kind of things do I want to have in the sauna? You know, like I said, feedback not just from practitioners, but from individuals as well. And I used to have the ceramic heaters. And the problem with the ceramic heaters, people complain about the hot spots and the cold spots. Usually it's, you know, you got a heater that's 9 inches by, you know, 3 inches with a reflector behind. So it gets quite hot against your back and you move over and quite cool. And so with the carbon fiber, it's much more even coverage. So we have the whole back wall, the whole side walls covered with carbon fiber. And then we found it a little bit cool below the waist. So we put a heater underneath the bench itself, and we push the side heaters in front of the bench down to the floor and towards the front wall. I wanted to put a heater in the floor as well, because you can, if you heat up the feet, people tend to sweat a little bit faster, but I didn't want it exposed to the sweat. So we put a ceramic tile over top of the heater in the floor. And we also put some additional heaters at the front wall. So we tried to have it that when someone's in there, they feel totally enveloped with the heat. And what happens is they tend to sweat profusely at a lower temperature. And so if someone has never used an infrared sauna before, you don't come out feeling drained. You could actually have a sauna, have a shower, and go to work. I could never do that in a conventional sauna. You'd be kind of too wiped out. The other thing is to make sure in the sauna that everything is non-toxic. So we had, even after saunas were built and it's all real wood, I sent the sauna, a brand new sauna, to an independent lab and had independent VOC testing. It stands for volatile organic compounds, and they measure parts per million. Because I sell to a lot of people with MCS, multiple chemical sensitivity, and I was very chemically sensitive myself. When I was sick, so I'm very aware of that. And the other issue to bring up is EMF, electromagnetic field. And you know, it's electromagnetic field is something we're all exposed to in your work, in your home. It's, you know, something that's there. But in an infrared sauna, you're very close to the heaters. So for instance, let's say, I'm not suggesting only a microwave, but someone had a microwave, you went within 2 inches, it'd measure about 30 milligauss. If you back off 2 feet, it drops down to zero. Now in an infrared sauna, you don't have the luxury of backing off. You're always sitting within 1 or 2 inches of the heaters. So we eventually got ours really low, down to 0.3 milligauss at point of body contact. That would be the wooden slats you lean against. We also brought down the EF, which is measured in volts per meter, and we brought that down below TCO or Swedish standards as well, which is great because now autistic kids can use their sauna, people with cancer can use their sauna. It's worked out really well, and the feedback, you know, has helped me build the saunas that we have today.
So basically, from what I hear you saying, is that your sauna is extremely low in VOCs, volatile organic compounds, as well as EMFs.
Well, it's not just extremely low, it's zero as far as VOCs, but it's not zero with EMF. Our EMF would be 0.3 milligauss. Okay. What has bothered me, Tracy, there's a little bit of deception in the market, and I sure won't mention any company's names because I don't like going that route, but I always tell people, look, if you're looking for a sauna and someone says they're non-toxic, say, great. Please provide me with independent VOC testing. And then look at it closely to see, did they just test the heaters in isolation, or did an independent lab test actually go and test the new sauna? Because that's the environment you're going to be sitting in. And it's the same with EMF. If you go online, a number of companies will state zero or low EMF. But the majority, I hate to say it, but the majority, if they do any testing at all, they just test the heaters at a lab in isolation. So that means they're not including electrical connection and wiring. And what you and I care about is the environment we're sitting in. And so it's very alarming. And that's why I've written on my website some questions, what to look for in buying an infrared sauna, because I feel bad. People have, whether on disability or limited funds, and they're just buying these saunas for their health, and they have no idea, unless they have a Gauss meter, they have no idea they're sitting in this really strong electromagnetic field. So to me, it's irresponsible. It only costs about maybe $1,500, $2,000 to have your whole sauna tested for EMF. And when they're doing testing, and you're taking averages, it should be a point of body contact, the wooden slides you're leaning against. Because, you know, you can always fool around with figures if you like. You can, if you're doing some testing, you can walk in the door and it's zero, up the ceiling at zero. You take a lot of readings and you're sauna at zero. Then you get to the wooden slats you lean against, or point of body contact, it could be 10 milligauss, but a company can say they average two. So in ours, I had an independent lab. I told them, I said, look, take over 100 readings in the sauna, and everything has to be under two, which is Swedish standards. But I said, when you're taking averages, all the readings have to be at point of body contact, the wooden slats you lean against. So when I'm telling someone that's averaging 0.3 milligauss, they're welcome to take a Gauss meter, and that's what they'll discover. And it's, you know, you just have to be, you know, as a consumer, you have to be careful because, you know, a lot of these, you know, there's a lot of hype out there. You know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I do. And I've fallen for the hype, and I'm just so thankful that I was introduced to you from my friend Molly, because you know, I almost made a big mistake and bought one of the big popular saunas, and I'm so glad that I didn't. So,
I was very pleased too.
Well, there's just, you know, I really, really want to help people be healthy. And I know because my expertise is more in nutrition and food and fitness, is just the dogma that the food companies feed people and that they believe it. And the dogma that the medical community you know, with their drugs and the pharmaceuticals and how people believe all that. And it drives me crazy.
Oh, yeah, me too. And to be honest with you, I was quite, before I had my health problem, I was quite naive, quite ignorant. I thought health food stores were for hippies and yuppies. So it just goes to show you that until you have some problems yourself, it was a big wake-up call for me. I was very mainstream medicine. And now, yeah, I would still go to the hospital if I had a car accident and had a broken leg, but I would avoid it like the plague if I don't have to, you know. The other thing that I forgot to address is on the market, you'll see some stuff to do with near infrared, okay, or sometimes full spectrum, which includes near infrared. And I really looked into that to see, is there any advantages to having near infrared heaters in my sauna? And the more research that I did, the more I discovered that it's the best way to go is just to stay with far infrared, because there is good research on near infrared. Okay, but the research is done with light-emitting diodes and lasers, okay, and mostly kind of 630 to 940 nanometers, or some in the near-infrared and some in the red range. It shows tissue repair, wound healing, all kinds of benefits, okay? And I knew about this probably 10 years ago because I have a light paddle myself, an LED paddle. And if you have an injured thumb, for instance, you might actually apply that on the thumb, but the trouble is, the research being done on LED lights or lasers, they all do it either touching the skin or touching the petri dish, or extremely close to it. And there's a reason for that. It's called the inverse square law from a light source. You go, what does that mean? If you're 6 inches away from a light source, you go 6 times 6 is 36, and you put a 1 over top, and so you're only getting 1/36 the intensity versus 1 inch away. If you're 10 inches away, you're getting 1/100 the intensity. That's why all the research papers are showing it's touching the skin or touching the petri dish. And so to me, again, I think it's irresponsible to make claims regarding the saunas, okay, to use that research. So I threw it out there and I just said, okay, show me some research about near infrared regarding sauna. And I kind of put it as an open letter, you know, and the responses that I got back were showing the same research that I found on light emitting diodes and lasers and a very specific frequency. So I'm not a great fan as far as near infrared and saunas. People are still benefiting. They are sweating. You could put hardware bulbs in the sauna and you're still sweating, just like you're sweating in a conventional sauna. But if you go to a store, whether it's Costco or some home hardware store, and you buy a near infrared heater, nobody's making any claims about it. So that's my concern. And so it kind of, I would stick with, as far as whether someone buys a sauna for me or somebody else, I would be buying a far infrared sauna because that's what the research supports.
So let me ask you a question with that said. So if somebody wanted the other health benefits that come from near infrared, which I know that there's other things, is there a device that will work in conjunction? Because I know Molly has something that she bought recently that she sits in her sauna like 3 or 4 times a week, but she has something else that she uses for red light therapy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is. I'm a fan of red light therapy or near infrared. I don't using that application with very, very close to touching the skin. And so it's not a product that I'd recommend. Just find out, I guess, what frequency it is in, okay, and maybe the intensity. And it should be, you know, 630 to 940 nanometers. So you've got some in the near infrared. Near infrared is kind of, you know, 700 to 1400 nanometers. Red light is 630 to 700. So anywhere 630 to 940, just, you know, if you bought a red light device or an LED device, and you could apply it to the skin. You know, it's not something that I sell. I just am more concerned about the companies that state, hey, we have near infrared lights in our sauna. And it's just, to me, it's, and when something starts on the net, I've noticed, you know, and nothing against the doctors, they're very busy practices. And then I think, and sometimes they're endorsing saunas that may be higher in EMF than they realize, or they may have some VOCs, but they don't know. And it's the same with the near infrared. They may endorse it. And I don't think they've put I spent hours going into PubMed and Medline looking at the research paper, and I have yet to find one to do with near infrared regarding saunas. And so there's, you know, to me, it doesn't apply. Like I said, the you know, it's, so anyway, I'll get off my bandwagon about knee arthritis. I just have concerns because sometimes people will buy that thinking it's the way to go. And they're still, to be fair, they're still benefiting from sweating. But you can't take the research, from my humble opinion, you can't take the research on light emitting diodes and lasers and then saying that same research applies to your sauna.
Oh, yeah. Totally. Yeah. And they're charging more for the full spectrum ones, like at least $1,000 more.
Yeah. So that's, I have my concerns. If they can show some research to support what they're saying, fantastic. But I've you know, had customers ask the companies that are doing that and just said, okay, you know, show me some research to support what you're saying. And they'll send the same research that I found, you know, on PubMed or Medline, showing on light emitting diodes and lasers. Well, that's, you know, and with touching the skin. So you can't, to me, you can't take that information and say, okay, this is applying to our sauna too.
Now, would that light be hot with the near infrared? How can they touch the skin? Is it warm?
No, light emitting diodes is slightly warm, but it's not in that correct frequency. You know, kind of, it's not, the red gets a little bit hotter, but the near infrared hardly gives off any heat at all if it's in the correct frequency.
Okay.
Like I said, you can get a hot air heater at Costco that's giving off near infrared, but it's not getting the same health benefits because it's not in the same frequency as these LED lights or the intensity. So you're looking at the two issues, the intensity and the frequency of the lights.
Got
so
it.
Yeah, you can hold it against your skin and it gets a little bit warm. These ones where you go to a hardware store and you see it, some companies online, you know, make your own hardware store and you got these big bulbs. Well, they're so hot, you have to sit kind of 12, the company recommends you sit 12 to 24 inches away. Well, even if they had some in the correct frequency, because of the inverse square law, you're not really getting much benefits. But to be fair, you are sweating, okay? But you're not, from my perspective, you're not getting the benefits that they're seeing.
Right, yeah, I totally hear what you're saying. That makes absolute sense. And how long have you had your company?
20 years.
20 years? Oh my gosh, yeah. Randy, I didn't realize that.
Yeah, no, it's just over 20 years now. It's kind of, yeah, I was doing it, you know, it's the old thing. I was still actually with the fire department at the time and then doing it part-time. And then I realized I couldn't do both effectively, right? So I quit the fire department job or took an early retirement. And I've been doing this full-time for a long time now.
And where are you guys located?
We're based in Vancouver,
okay.
British Columbia, Canada. So yeah, no, it's, we have, it's interesting. I do have getting more and more practitioners down in the U.S., which is nice because like I said, a lot of times people say, where can I go? I can't afford one can't fit in. Where can I go to use it? And so I'm always pleased to sell to practitioners. So then people have that opportunity to try it out. And there's been, as far as the health benefits, I originally was just selling to people with toxin problems, heavy metals, whether it's mercury or lead or you know, aluminum and toxic issues. But now, you know, there's a rheumatoid arthritis study came out. There's one with, this is using far infrared saunas, and there's one with congestive heart failure and high blood pressure. I've also been selling a lot more to personal trainers, which I sure never sold to before. And they're finding that for their athletes, there's, I think Dr. Patrick Ronda has some stuff on hypothermia, you know, heat performance. It's been some really interesting stuff out there. And what you have to be careful with, if you have a client, for instance, that is quite toxic, even if they're tempted, okay, they'll feel really good using the sauna, but I strongly suggest they don't start off doing the sauna daily right out of the get-go, okay, because what will happen is they'll feel really good to about day, maybe three, day four. They're going to have a major Herxheimer reaction, headache, flu-like symptoms. Now, my theory with this, and it's just my own theory, but it just makes sense, is you're immobilizing 90% of your toxins and heavy metals to your skin. But to be fair, and I just came up with 90%, I have no idea if it's 90% or 85% or whatever, but and let's say it's 10%, that your liver is having to deal with. And if you already have compromised phase two detox pathways, of course, it makes it worse. So if you go a little bit slower, if someone's toxic, and any most people with chronic health problems may be toxic, you might start off doing it every 3 days. And you might do that for 3 or 4 weeks. And then you might, then after that, you might do it every other day for 3 or 4 weeks, and then daily. So, and you'll listen to your body. So you slowly work up, and it seems to work way better. You know, it's interesting because even people with the label of MS, for instance, and I'm not saying with everybody with MS has a toxin problem or a heavy metal problem, but I personally believe there's a subset that have high levels of mercury, and the number of people with the MS diagnosis that have bought saunas and dramatically improved is really high. That I have personally, you know, been introduced to, and so it's been fascinating. It doesn't mean that they have to be careful. They have to start off a little bit slower. They have to talk at a lower temperature because they are strongly affected by the heat. But it doesn't mean they can't use an infrared sauna. They just have to go a little bit more carefully.
And how many minutes per session?
Most time I go in, you know, 30 to 40 minute sessions. Probably advertise 35. So you have to make sure that you're replacing both your electrolytes and your water because you are sweating profusely. And someone says, well, how do you know if you're drinking enough water? And there's no, I haven't come up with some magic formula. Maybe with your background, you can come up with a magic formula for me, Tracy. But I think what I usually suggest is that people, when they're peeing or urinating later, if there's a stronger yellow color at all, then you better increase your water intake, right? So it should be either clear or maybe just a slight, you know, pale yellow is fine. And but also, as you mentioned earlier, it's the electrolytes that people are often low in. So sodium, potassium, and magnesium, and trace minerals. So I sometimes drink coconut water. I sometimes chew on dulse, which is a seaweed, sea vegetable. It's a bit of an acquired taste. You either like it or you hate it, okay? And so I do that, or sometimes I'll go to a store and I'll buy some sort of electrolyte mix. There's a few brands out there that I've used over the years. But yeah, it's interesting. Your body, as a defensive mechanism, if you're low in electrolytes and trace minerals, it minimizes your sweating. So sometimes I'll run into people and say, oh, I've always had difficulty sweating. And I'll say, well, the first thing to do is increase your electrolytes and trace minerals. And I didn't realize really the connection until myself, once I recovered, I now use the sauna, you know, probably 3 times a week. But when I was sick, I was using the sauna every day. And once but my month of June is kind of my detox month where I go in the sauna every day. I think we're all exposed to something, so I'll keep my toxic load down, right? And I was drinking lots of water. And I've been in the sauna for, I don't know, probably, you know, good, you know, 25 minutes. And I stopped sweating, and I'm overheating. I thought, what the heck is going on? And then I thought, wow, I wonder if I'm low in electrolytes and trace minerals. So I went out of the sauna, grabbed a handful of dulse, and went back in the sauna and was chewing it. And not right away, but I'd say after about 7 minutes, I was sweating profusely again. So I phoned one of the doctors I respect down in the States on detox, and I said, Ron, does your body as a defensive mechanism, if you're low in electrolytes and trace minerals, does it minimize your sweating? And he said, oh, yeah, definitely. So that was a real eye-opener for me, that connection.
That is interesting. I never heard of that, but I do know people who say that they don't sweat much, so I'll definitely mention that. And one thing I do I eat keto, like a ketogenic lifestyle, which means you're dumping water, you're dumping electrolytes. So I always coach people so that they avoid the keto flu, is that they need to replace electrolytes. So what I do is in the morning, I wake up, I drink a 16-ounce glass of water. When there's about 2 inches left, I add a teaspoon of really good quality salt, and I rotate through those, and a squeeze of a half a lemon.
Okay, that's a great idea. And that morning lemon is good for your liver too, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's good for adrenal function because your body's trying to bring the cortisol levels down from, you know, just to get your day going. And so it helps with adrenal fatigue as well, or the risk of that. So it helps your adrenals. But it makes a difference because then I go to the gym and I do a hardcore workout. And my performance is affected if I don't do my salt and lemon.
Okay, interesting. Wow, that's great to know.
Yeah, it's really interesting to see. And then it kind of goes back to, like, my husband loves to mountain bike in really high heat, like a 100-degree day. He'll love to be out sweating on the mountain midday. And one time I like bonked, you know, and I just felt bad. And so he gave me salt and instantly, like, I just felt good again.
Yeah, no, it's amazing, isn't it? And it's kind of, and there's, I think what I, over the years, there's been so much anti-salt stuff out there. And I think that's a big mistake. A lot of people don't, you know, they're not consuming healthy salt, right?
Yeah, totally. They're eating the blue thing with the girl with the umbrella, Morton's or something, which is stripped of everything, you know?
Yeah.
So, and then is asking, going back to your water question, I drink about a gallon a day. And like, it's how I feel good. And nobody's ever said, oh gosh, I feel worse because I'm drinking too much water, you know?
Yeah.
But I do about a gallon a day, and I always say drink a liter by 9, a liter by noon, a liter by 3, and a liter by 6. But for a larger person, the minimum they want, which I never go with the minimum, but the minimum is a half an ounce per pound of body weight.
Okay.
So if you're 200 pounds, then you want to have a minimum of 100 ounces.
Wow. Okay, yeah, no, I had heard that, but it's I'll confess, I probably should be drinking more water. I do when I'm doing the sauna sessions, but I know it's I have many friends that are much more conscious of the water, and it's something that I have to work on.
Yeah, and a lot of people don't like the taste, so I just say either do infused water or herbal teas that have, you know, a good flavor. Or I have a soda stream, so I'm pumping some CO2 into my water to make it bubble water.
And yeah, actually, that's funny with SodaStream. My partner, she introduced me to that, and my water consumption has gone up tremendously, right?
Oh, gosh, I love it. I just love the bubbles.
Yeah. Oh, it makes it like a nice, yeah. No, it's quite funny. I probably have doubled my water intake since then.
Good. I always tell people it's amazing. So I wanted to ask you another question. When we spoke last time, you talked about two things that I want to make sure we get to. One is the documentary that you're in, and the other one is the finished study, because I really want people to understand how they're going to change their life with a sauna.
Okay, well, I think it's coming back again in April, but I was part of a very, to be fair, a very small part on something called the Human Longevity Project, where they went to different places in the world and they looked at people that live longer. Very well done documentary, so it will be coming up again in April, a re-showing of it, and it, you know, it doesn't cost anything to see it, and I was privileged to have a part in it where I talked about the saunas. Now, as far as the it's an interesting kind of I guess my take on it is with the sauna use. I feel kind of foolish. Can you repeat the question?
Oh, yeah. Okay, so I asked you two, so let's just do one at a time. The finished study. Right.
Okay, the finished study. Here I was trying to, I was thinking, I was stalling, Tracy. I think I'm going to come up with a question to you at any minute, right? And of course I did, and I felt like an idiot. Anyway, so with a finished study, this is a conventional sauna use, but still the idea of sauna use. They took 20-year period. Okay, they took 2,100 middle-aged men, okay? And then they wanted to see how it affected their lives as far as longevity. They looked at heart disease. They looked at high blood pressure. They looked at cancer. And overall, okay, so this study was done over 20 years. So you can't tell me that that's not a good database. 2,100 middle-aged men. And over that time period, and they were using the sauna because it's conventional sauna, they were averaging probably 14 minutes a day, okay, because you can't stay in a conventional sauna that long. And the people that were using it like two or three times a week increased longevity by all these different things, like heart disease, cancer, by, you know, probably about, I think it was 23%. But the people that were using it four times a week or more, it averaged about 48%. I mean, I was shocked when I read that. But if someone told you that if you were doing a sauna four times a week or more, or even if you do it slightly less than that, but that you could increase your longevity from all these different factors by, you know, almost 50%, you go, wow, that's incredible. And then they took, the researchers in Finland took the same data, the same group of people, and then they looked at dementia and Alzheimer's, and they discovered that it reduced it by, one was, I don't remember which one was, dementia or Alzheimer's, but one was 64%, the other was 65%. And you think, holy smokes, that's, now there's a bunch of different reasons why may be having an effect on the body. Shock proteins, lowering heavy metals, you could go down the list of ideas that they have, but that's the results. And so to me, we shouldn't underestimate the idea of bringing in a sauna use as part of your normal lifestyle. Right?
That is incredible. There's nothing else that I've ever heard that can do that.
Yeah, no, even if I was expecting after the study, well, it might increase longevity by 15% or something. But when you come out with the figures of 48%, and then with, you know, because unfortunately these days, dementia and Alzheimer's is a big issue. And if someone said to you, okay, you could reduce the incidence of that by 65%, you go, wow, that's incredible, right?
That is absolutely incredible. And I personally, my mom has Alzheimer's. She's still at the kind of the beginning, but she forgets stuff every single day.
Yeah.
And so I just had a genetic test to see if I have any of the genes, and so I'm waiting to see, but I do know about genetic expression as well.
And of course they, and you, where it'd be helpful with your background and your knowledge is, of course, they're finding some of the treatment protocols, of course, has a lot to do with the diet, right?
Oh yeah. I mean, I tried to change her diet, but she did great for a while and then she slipped back, and she's a carboholic, you know, like crackers and cereal and bread. And I tried to get her all of that off of it, but she just went right back. So whatever.
Yeah. Well, you can only, it's always the hardest with family members, Tracy.
Yeah. I know. I have people that don't hardly know me that listen to what I say and they do it. And then I have, you know, people that I'm closest to that think I'm wacky. So,
because you got that family history, right?
Yeah, I'm just like, whatever. So,
so it just goes to show, you know, to be fair, these studies were done on conventional sauna, but you're still doing the same thing. You're sweating profusely, you're raising the core temperature. I believe because of the penetration, that in infrared saunas, you can mobilize more toxins and heavy metals than in a conventional sauna. It's just, we've done challenge tests. Let's say that someone has high in mercury, and all they've done, they haven't done chelation, they've just done the sauna, and then we've done another challenge test, let's say, you know, 6 months later, and usually they've dropped the mercury levels by, you know, 2/3 to 3/4. That's significant, right?
Wow. Yes, that's very, very significant.
Yeah, now to be fair, these people are probably doing the sauna 5 or 6 days a week, but they have mercury problems and there's something you want to do with it. And there's some really good studies out there looking at sweat analysis and heavy metals. I mean, there's not just a few studies, there's lots of them out there that's supporting that sweating is the way to go as far as heavy metals. And you have the advantages, it bypasses the liver and the kidneys, right? Because a lot of times people with heavy metal problems may have compromised liver and kidneys. So there's, you know, it just takes that pressure off, right?
You know, you just made me think of something, Randy. So my day job is I'm in dental sales. And what I was thinking is people in a dental office, because of removing amalgams, and most of them don't do it in a safe way, I'm sure. They probably have high levels of mercury toxicity, would you think?
Oh, I sold the saunas a lot to dentists and dental assistants. Sometimes their mercury levels are off the chart. And, you know, granted, more recently they've been using, you know, they have oxygen in the rubber dams and stuff like that, but that's probably more recent and more with what we'll call biological dentists. But believe me, there's a lot of dentists that aren't doing, they might decide to remove the silver amalgams because, you know, that's what their patient is requesting, but they're not doing it properly. And they themselves are extremely exposed with the, you know, the grinding and the vapor. I mean, it's not like, you know, so yeah, it's something I sell to a lot of dentists and a lot of dental assistants because of that.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. I'm actually going to talk to him, and I have a device. I'm a bioenergetics practitioner.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It is amazing. Okay. So I can scan somebody's body, get the biofeedback, and it will determine what their level of toxicities are, among other things. Like, it basically measures distortions and blockages in the energy fields. And So are you familiar with any of that type of stuff?
Yeah, I am.
Okay. So it will determine whether they have heavy metal toxicity. And so I had it, and I had to go on a whole protocol for all that. But so I'm working on that for myself. So that's interesting that maybe we can help these doctors in conjunction with each other and show them their toxicity levels and then show them a really great solution.
Yeah. Because it's kind of like, they started to recognize, finally that silver amalgams, right, aren't the way to go, and they're 50% mercury, and they leach out over time, and, the studies are there now, but this, it's still, the younger, more modern trained are using composites, and they're avoiding mercury, but they're still out there, there's still places that are putting, or dentists that are still putting mercury in the mouth, right?
Yeah, there are. And I'm in California, and I don't know of anybody who is a biological dentist that is actually removing them properly.
Yeah, it's kind of, the other thing is when they remove them properly, and of course I had mine done, an interesting thing in Sweden I discovered years ago is they give, so let's say you go through the whole proper protocol and you have the IV and, everything, and you have the oxygen pumped in, you have the dam and that. They give their patients 5 grams of activated charcoal about 15 minutes before they have the dental work, and then about, let's say, 15 minutes after they've done this. So 15 minutes before and 15 minutes after, they take these 5 grams of activated charcoal. Now, long-term use of activated charcoal can interfere with mineral absorption, things like that, but short-term, as far as having that work done, meaning that if any mercury did get by the dam or something, at least it's not being taken up by your body, you have another means of getting it out.
Oh, that's a really good idea.
Yeah, and I don't know, it doesn't seem to be kind of, common knowledge out there, but it's definitely something that I did. I also, as soon as I got home, of course, I hopped in my sauna, right?
Oh, yeah, that's smart. Yeah. It's so something else that you may not know is that dentists have the highest rate of suicide.
Yeah, I did know that. And I think, it's
the mercury. It
could be the mercury,
It's, that matters.
It can be the stress of the job, too, but high levels of mercury, and some of the... I like the fact that you're able to do the testing that you're talking about doing, because you have to be careful. Let's say, for instance, with some of the chelators, you just have to be, I'm cautious with some of them, DMPS and DMSA, right?
Okay, that just went right over my head.
Oh, there's 2 chelators out there, okay, that sometimes people will go for IV if they have high levels of mercury in the body or high levels of lead, okay? And 2 of them are called DMPS and DMSA. And if you go that route, if you do, I'm not suggesting you do that, but if you go that route, definitely go to a doctor that knows what they're doing, because there's a certain rate they should be taking out of your body. And to me, the safer way is by sweating through the sauna.
Yeah, I would say that. The way I take this thing, have you heard of imprinted water?
I've read about it, but I don't know a lot about it. I've read an article one time.
Okay, I'll shoot you some information, but it's, I think it would be a great complement to what you're already doing with, clients sweating, because it actually does it from an internal perspective and from the energy pathway. So it helps facilitate movement. So
interesting.
Yeah, it's so interesting. It goes over my head. Like, I'm really, really studying physics right now and learning about it, because I believe it's the future of medicine.
And that's cool.
Yeah, it's super cool. So, okay, the other thing I want to do, because we're starting to run out of time, is, so what is the name of that documentary?
It's called the Human Longevity Film. If you Google that, Human Longevity Film. I guess Jason would be the host. I can send you a link after.
Okay, cool. And then they can listen to it again in April?
Yes, it'll be kind of live there now. You can pay for it now and listen to it now, but it'll be free again in April. So I'll send you a link, Tracy.
Okay, we'll put that in the show notes.
Okay,
so
great.
What advice would you give to our listeners, Randy?
Well, my advice would be regarding saunas is that if you can afford one, great. It would be something that you will use for the rest of your life. And you just adopt it into your kind of lifestyle. And it's another means to keep people's toxic load down. When I was young, there was no such thing as leukemia wards for kids, but there is now. I believe everybody's toxic load is too high. So we can do something to keep your toxic load down. And you also have the benefits of the sauna is that you've come out feeling relaxed and refreshed. People talk about improving skin tone, and like I said, athletes go in there and they often do stretching in there soon after coming out, and they can increase the range of motion. You just have to be careful you don't overstretch. So yeah, so if I was to summarize, just say that if you were to do one thing from my, and I'm, obviously I'm biased, but if you were to do one thing to add to your regime, whether it's exercise or just general health, it would be incorporate the sauna, the far infrared sauna into it. And if you do decide to look for one, and it'd be great if you were to call me, but if you decide to go with another company, definitely look at all those questions. And the questions are actually on my website as far as what to look for when buying a far infrared sauna or buying an infrared sauna.
And then the listeners get a special offer?
Yeah, I definitely, any of your listeners, I would identify that that's coming from you, and I will definitely give them a discount.
Awesome. So use the code, you guys. Use High Energy Girl, and Randy will give you a discount. I'm telling you guys, I have done a lot of research for actually more than a year on an infrared sauna, and this is the one that you want. Absolutely. And I'm super excited to meet you and to know you and to have all of our listeners, you know, hear your story and all of your really, really deep research. So I want to implore everyone to do their own research. So thank you so much for coming on our show today, Randy.
Well, it was an honor to be on it, Casey. Thanks again.
You are amazing. And I so look forward to when I make my way up to Canada to come and see you.
Well, you definitely have to come to Vancouver, and I'll have to come down. Whereabouts do you live in California?
In the Bay Area.
All right. Well, then that's perfect. So we're both in beautiful climates, right?
Yeah, we live on a little organic farm out in the country in the Bay Area, believe it or not.
Oh cool. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's cool.
Well, thanks again for having me.
Okay, sweetie. Thank you.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Wow, was that crazy? I mean, so many people are getting these illnesses. They're getting autoimmune disease. They are getting it from toxins, typically, lifestyle choices. There's just, we live in a toxic world. Come on, let's just face it. And if you could sit every day or every other day and relax for 35 minutes, it's going to help you with your detoxification as well as your stress level. So the sauna game is really important. It's really healthy. And I hope that you'll go head on over to his website, radianthealthsaunas.com. For complete show notes, head on over to highenergygirl.com/show. And make sure you subscribe to the show. Share it with your friends because I have a slew of fantastic guests coming up. And I can't wait for you to check them out and listen to their tips for you. So the tip for this show is get a sauna. If you can't afford a sauna, then go out and find one in your local town that you can use regularly. All right, you guys, make it a great day. This podcast contains the opinion and thoughts of its host and guests. It is intended to provide helpful and informative material on the subjects covered. All statements made on the podcast have not been evaluated by the FDA and are not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent disease. If the listener requires professional assistance or advice, please contact your personal medical doctor. Both host and guest specifically disclaim any responsibility for any liability, loss, or risk, personal or otherwise, which is incurred as a consequence directly or indirectly of the use and application of any of the contents of these episodes. Like I said, this is my opinion, and I could be wrong.